Hello everybody, welcome to this session. I'm going to speak about how you can monitor your Java application with logs, metrics, pings and traces. My name is David Pilato. I'm coming from France. We're speaking French here. Some people are speaking French. Yeah, maybe. So this talk will be in English, but in French English. Okay, so I hope you will be able to understand my accent. Anyway, so I'm Dadoune on Twitter. So this talk started with this tweet, actually. So anytime you have a new architecture based on microservices, and every time you have an outage, it can become super tricky to find what is the root cause of the issue. Like, it's like a murder mystery that you have to solve. So sometimes you have fire in your production system, but this is a small fire somewhere in the production and you don't really care about it because this is all fine. But at some point it will become a problem because everything will start to burn, and then it will be super tricky to find what was actually the root cause. And to solve that problem, what we recommend you is to log and to collect all the information that you can, and basically all the things that you can collect, like logs, pings, performance information, what have you. So I'm David, I told you that already. I'm developer and evangelist at Elastic, and what I'm doing basically as a developer, I'm building Hello World application. This is what I can do nowadays. But I'm trying to monitor those applications. And this talk is based on a talk that my colleague Philip Crane built. So all the information that you are going to see today is available in this repository. So this is Philip's repository. So if you want to play with all the things that I'm going to showcase today, then you can just have a look at this repository. For the application that I'm going to use, I'm using Spring Boot. But I can use whatever other framework. And my application is super simple. I have a front-end, I have a back-end, and the back-end is communicating with a MySQL database. And in the front-end, I can do really small and tiny things. I'm going to show you the code, so you will have a better understanding of how is the code made. So to monitor all the things, what we recommend is to use the Elastic Stack. Obviously, I'm working at Elastic, so I'm biased. Please don't trust me, try yourself after the talk. And at Elastic, we are building this stack. And this stack is based on mainly Elasticsearch. So Elasticsearch is the core, is the heart of the stack, where you basically send JSON documents. Those JSON documents are stored, and then you are able to search and analyze in real time for whatever volume of data that you have collected. Speaking of collecting data, we can use ingest layer. So the ingest layer is based on two different components. One is named, the name is Bits. So the Bits component are agents that you put on your edge machine where you want to collect the data. And you can collect logs with FileBit, for example. So it will basically stream the logs from the source with FileBit and send that to Elasticsearch. And you will be able to then search for the logs that you have indexed. If you want to collect information about metrics, like metric system or metrics coming from a given application, then you can use MetricBit, and this is the same thing. We are collecting the data with MetricBit, sending that to Elasticsearch. If you want to know what is happening on the network card, you can run PacketBit. PacketBit is like Wireshark running on your machine, and it will try to understand what is running. For example, if you have a SQL Postgres database, it will read the network flow on the Postgres port, and then it will index in Elasticsearch all the requests that that have been seen over the Postgres protocol. What you have? You have Heartbeat as well. Heartbeat is like a ping. if you want to monitor if your service is up or down, or what is the latency, then you can use Heartbeat, to ping your services and monitor your services like this. You have also Auditbeat for everything related to security, for example. And then once you have indexed that in Elasticsearch, you can use Kibana to visualize everything that has been indexed inside Elasticsearch. So we are going to see all those three things today. We have also another tool named Logstash. And Logstash is like an ETL where you extract data from a source, you transform the data on the fly, and then you load to whatever destination. So the source could be bits, for example. You can read something from a file bit, send that to Logstash. With Logstash, do some transformation, do some enrichment of the data, like doing a lookup in a SQL data store, for example, to gather more information about whatever event. And then send that to multiple destinations. It can be Elasticsearch, obviously, but it can be S3 Amazon, for example, if you want to store the logs, to archive them there, for example, you can do that. So Logstash is an ETL, basically. We have also APM agent, which is not on this picture, but it's like a bits component. So I will show you that. If you want to deploy the stack, you have multiple options for that. You can just download the stack locally and run it by yourself. This is basically what I'm going to show you. Everything is running here locally on my laptop. Otherwise, you can use also what we call Elastic Cloud Enterprise, which comes with a fully managed version of the stack, like you have automatic backups, rolling upgrades when you want to update a version of Elastic Stack, for example. And the same software that we are using for Elastic Cloud Enterprise, we are using it to power our SaaS offer. So the name is Elastic Cloud, where you can find Elasticsearch as a service, Kibana as a service, and so on. All the things that I'm going to show you today are available for free, so you can just use that in your production system without any problem. If at some point I mention something which is not free, I will explicitly say, oh, this feature is a commercial feature, right? Otherwise, everything is free. Yes, so speaking about Elastic Cloud, this is a unique way to have access to the stack and also to some commercial features that we have that I will mention maybe later, like the machine learning feature for anomaly detection and things like that. And it's super easy to configure, like you can decide whatever architecture you want. If you want to have a hot warm architecture, for example, then you can just choose a template and then adapt the template to your needs. Anyway, so let's move to the demo part. I'm going to switch from one mic to another. Yeah, can you still hear me? That's okay? Okay. So I'm going to share my screen here. We are going to look at what we have running for now on my laptop. So, let's remove that. So I have a Docker Compose file, and so I started already the Docker Compose process. And in the Docker Compose process, I'm starting a lot of things, so basically the whole stack, including Elasticsearch and Kibana. So as everything is ready, I can just connect to Kibana and have access to whatever Kibana is going to propose me. By the way, you can see that we have here security available. So from 6.8 version of the stack and 7.1 version of the stack, we are providing now authentication for free. So you can now secure your cluster easily. So I can log in. So I will have here a front page telling me what I can do with the stack, for example. What I'm going to look at for the first time is the monitoring part. So we are trying to monitor our own services, so the stack which is running. So with that, I'm going to discover what part of the stack are actually running here on my laptop. So when I go to monitoring,
I have here an Elasticsearch running. I have only one node. As you can see, I'm using the basic license, so this is the free version of the stack. I have one Kibana instance. Obviously, I'm using this one. And I have also here four bits components. So I have file bits, I mentioned it, for logs, earth bit to monitor services if they are up or down, metric bit about metrics, and packet bit about the network card. And then I have also an APM server running here. So I can do application performance management and monitoring. So I have that running. I can go here to the bits part and see. So I have some events which are collected whenever something is happening. I don't have many events coming from the file bit part. This is, yes, what I'm expecting because I'm not using my application. So I'm not generating any logs for now. We'll see that later. So I have earth bits running. And one of the first things I can do with Kibana is to go to this Discover application, where I can try to look at my indices. So the first thing I need to do when you come to Kibana is to define an index pattern. And here I want to define an index pattern for my Earthbit indices. So the Earthbit indices are where I'm collecting all the information gathered by the Earthbit agent. So next step. So I have a timestamp, which is my field regarding to date. And because I have now this index available, I can go to Discover and see what is happening. So over the last hour, I have seen that I have some events here that are collected by Earthbit. If I look at the events themselves, this is the events that we are collecting here. So, oh, I'm sorry. I'm not on the right. I want to be on the Earthbit one. So this is the Earthbit one. So here, I have the events that I'm collecting. So for example, this one, is that big enough? Yeah, I can zoom in a bit. So this one, yeah, I'm doing a ping on the Kibana machine, for example. So this is basically what I'm doing. If I look at the URL full here, I can see the top five things that I'm monitoring. So for example, I'm monitoring here MySQL, the Java front end, the Java back end, so I know where those things are running. This is probably Elasticsearch itself and Elasticsearch, the machine that I can ping. I'm going to add this one. So here you can see what is the URL that I'm the services that I'm monitoring, and I can also look at the monitor status. If I look at this one, I'm going to add it, so we can see that it's up, basically. Okay, all the services are up, which is okay, which is good. So if we look at the dates, yeah, 43 seconds here and 38. So every 5 seconds. The Earthbit system is sending a ping, a HTTP request, what have you, to the service that we want to monitor, collecting this, transforming that to JSON, and then this is indexed in Elasticsearch. And this is what we are able to see right here. So let's try to see if I can understand more things about what I have here. So with Kibana, what you can do is to build a visualization. So a visualization is something like this. So I'm creating a vertical bar visualization here on the Earthbit indices. So on the x-axis, I want to use what we call a date histogram. And basically, I want to split all the events by date. Okay, so this is what I have. So those are the number of events that I have for a given time frame. Then I want to split, so this one is gone. I want to add sub-buckets and I want to split the series by the monitor's status, the one that we have seen just before. So status, here, let's do that. So I just have services that are up now, so I don't see any split, but we are going to cover that later. What I can do as well, I'm going to split the charts, and I want to have a repartition of the events per service. So let's use the URL then, full here. And because I have more than five, let's consider that I have 15 at most services. So this is what we can see here. So those are the services that I'm monitoring. So this one is the ping for Kibana. This one is the ping, we are trying to check that MySQL is available and up, et cetera, et cetera. So we can see here how good our service is. We can do a refresh if we want to update that. And we can also say, okay, let's have a look at the last 15 minutes instead and have an auto refresh of, I don't know, 2 seconds, for example. So every 2 seconds, which is too much because we are collecting data every 5 seconds, so 5 would be enough. So here, every 5 seconds, we are going to refresh this dashboard and see what is happening. So let's have some fun now. So I'm going to kill the front end to see if this can be detected by a heartbeat. So to do that, I'm going to open my front end here. So I have a Docker version of my frontend. So this is a Java application, a Spring Boot one. So I'm going to kill this application. So this is killing the container. And automatically in my Docker Compose file, I said that every time the service is down, then restart the service automatically. So it should be coming back again. So let's see, yes. So we can see something wrong here, right? This is down, the service is down. I'm going to make that more obvious. You can change the color. It's cool. Okay, so the service is down, and probably after some time, the service is going to recover and restart again, and probably Heartbeat is going to find this out. So let's see, still down. The other services are okay, but this one is down. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure how long it will take. Oh, I think there are some green coming. Is that green again? Okay, so the service is green again, right? So I was able to see that there is an issue here with my service. It went down and is back again to normal. Okay, so I'm going to stop the auto-refresh. I don't need that anymore. So this is okay. Maybe we can have a look at the how it's made in the Docker Compose file. So as I said, I have the Elasticsearch running in my Docker Compose, some other details like my login, password, and so on. Kibana instance, file bit, I'm not going to cover that here, but I have the Heartbeat one. So here, I have Heartbeat running, and I define a Heartbeat configuration file where I exactly describing what are the services that I want to monitor. So this is this file. Here, and this is where I'm telling that I want to do a ping every 5 seconds on those hosts. And this is how the things is collected, basically. And I want to do also HTTP every 5 seconds on my Elasticsearch node, my Kibana node, and then my backend and my frontend HTTP services, right? And then a ping, not a ping, a TCP connection with MySQL to make sure that MySQL is active, okay? So this is the only configuration that you need to provide. Good. So this is okay. I have a response, but I feel like it's a bit too much work to do to build those visualizations, actually. I don't want to do that every time. So what we decided at Elastic is to provide you more application, ready-to-serve application. And one of the applications that we built, the name is Uptime. And this is the application that you can see here. This is basically going to show you the same thing, but already built, that you don't have to build anything. So you just go to Uptime, and then you have the same kind of experience that we have seen before, where you have all the events split by the status, like one of the service was done here, and we can see here which service was done. So this is exactly the same thing that we have seen, but now it's automatically managed by us. And if you go, for example, to this one, and want to have the detail, then you can see more information about what we have been collected, and when the service was done, for example, or all the information, or whatever you want, because we are collecting everything, right, in the index. Okay. So, I have other services running. One of the things we would like to collect as well is the logs. And to collect the logs, you can go to the front page of Kibana, and here you have a add log data button. You just have to follow the instructions, and that's pretty much easy. So if you want to collect, for example, Apache logs or MySQL logs, I'm going to collect MySQL logs here, you just go here, you say, okay, I'm, for example, on a Debian, you want to install Filebit, this is easy as that, and then you may want to modify the configuration if you need, and then you can enable the MySQL module. The MySQL module can do things for you automatically. And then you start the agent, and you check that the agent is running. I already started everything, so everything is running here. So yeah, I'm getting data from the Filebit agent. If I look at the configuration again in Docker Compose, let's go here. So here in Filebit, I'm mounting some volumes. So one for the backend logs, another one for the frontend logs, and another one for MySQL logs. If I look at my backend application, which I'm launching here. So this is a Java application. I'm just running it with Java, jar, and what have you. We are going to see that later. But what I'm doing here, I'm sharing the logs basically here in this space. And I'm doing the same thing for the front end. So let's connect again to the front end. And let's have a look at what we have. Oh, I need to go in my, what's the name? MNT project here. So here I have my front end log, and I can do tail-f front end log to see what I have here. So my service has just started. I have not that many logs, but I can generate a bit more. So let's go to the front-end application. So this is this one. I can generate like a call which is only calling a REST endpoint here, a REST endpoint with a parameter. Let's say foxed days, why not? And yeah, and I can see that I have some few things in the logs here available, right? And so this is the kind of thing that I want Filebit to collect, because I want to collect all that in a central place. I did not show you the code. No, I will show you the code later. So let's do other traces. Like, for example, I can do a null pointer exception. You are guys doing null pointer exception in your code? I'm doing that a lot of time. So I have one here. And if I look at the logs, oh, I have a very nice stack trace, right? This is normal. This is what I'm expecting. But the problem with that, when you want to collect that with Filebit, is that this single log is happening on multiple lines. And this can be hard to reconstruct a full event when you have multiple lines like this one, for example. So if you are Java developers, you can configure your logging framework to, instead of providing logs within a text file, using a JSON file instead. And this is what we are doing here in the code. I don't know if you have noticed. Oops. Here, I have also the frontend.json log here. If I look at this one, So this one is better because for each event, I have one single line, which is a JSON document. And this, for example, this line, this is the big one, contains all the stack trace that we need. Like, so for 5-bits, it's super easy then to collect that information because we just have one JSON document per line. We don't have to parse the document itself. We just have to send that to Elasticsearch. So that's easier. If you can do that, do that. That's definitely better. And with the configuration and the framework, the login framework that I'm using here, I can also generate some stack hash here, which is super useful because anytime I will have a stack trace, which is similar to this one, then I will generate the same hash. So this is super easy. If we look at the code and how this is happening, there is the logback here implementation, and here in logback, I have the standard log file, but here I'm generating the JSON document using this logging event composite JSON encoder, right? So this is how it's working. It's only logback configuration. So this JSON file is collected then by a file bit. If we look at the file bit configuration, it's here. So here, basically, I'm collecting the JSON log file for the backend and the JSON log file for the frontend. I'm also telling FileBit something else, that I want to add additional fields to every single event that I will be collected for the backend or every single event that I will be collected for the frontend. And here, for example, I'm adding a field named layer backend and layer front end. You are not forced to do that, but I'm doing that here just for the purpose of the demo. And I mentioned that I'm collecting things from MySQL as well. So I have the MySQL module here, which is enabled, and I'm capturing error logs and slow logs. Okay, that's it. Okay, so let's go to Discover again. Here, if I go to Discover, and now I want to open the logs, so 5-bit index. So I can see that over the last 15 minutes, I have generated some logs here. And if I look at the, for example, the slow log one, I'm going to call the slow API, because I have a slow API here. So for example, this one. So this one is slow. I need to refresh that. So it can take some seconds to be kept. So here I have some new logs here available. I'm going to remove this and this. I'm going to click on this one. So here I can see the event. And this one, yeah, the message was background task ran over a delay of, right, more than 1 second. Okay, so I have my logs. I can select, why not, the message field here. Okay, so those are the message, and I can see also the layer, so where those logs are coming from. So remember, the layer field is a field that I am adding to every single event. So here I can also add this one. Okay, and if I want, I can select only the documents coming from the front end, for example. So here, I can filter by this value, and here I'm just seeing the logs coming from the front end. That's good, right? But again, this is a bit too much complicated to me. What we can do instead is to use the new application that we have. The name is not that new, like it's some months ago. But we have a logs now application. And this is the same thing that I mentioned before with the uptime, with Earthbit. The logs application is basically looking at the file bit indices. And this is streaming. So this is showing you all the logs that have been collected so far. And I can also do a stream live here. So I'm collecting the logs, and anytime I have a new log, then this will appear just here. So this is like doing a tail-f on every single server, but on a central place. So I can search within this. For example, do I have good inside? Yeah, okay, I have good inside my log. So this is like doing a tail-f with a grep on all servers in a single place. So this is super handy to do that. What else can I do with that? I can generate maybe some other calls here, so we can see that happening there. So let's add some few things in the database. So I'm calling the front end and the back end. Let's generate more people and maybe search for people. So what my application is doing is generating fake data in the MySQL database, and then I'm reading back this data using Hibernate. Yeah. Okay, so look at the logs. Okay, so I can see the information that I collected. And remember that I'm collecting also slow logs from MySQL. So it's not slow, but just that I configured MySQL that after, I don't know, 10 milliseconds, I consider a request as slow, just to showcase that. It's not slow here, obviously. But this is one of the things that I have collected. And as I added a layer field, I can filter my logs and see only the backend event, for example. And let's do that. So now you have access only to the backend events, or you can do that for the frontend if you wish. Those are the frontend logs. So it's super easy to navigate in your logs. Okay? Then you can find what was the cause of the problem that you have seen. What time do I have? I have only 15 minutes left. This is right. Yeah. I need maybe to accelerate a bit. Okay, so I am also collecting information from MetricBit. So MetricBit is basically collecting metrics from the system. You have some metrics dashboard that are available when you first start MetricBit. It will configure automatically visualization and dashboard for you. So if I look at the metric bit overview, and then what's the name, host overview, okay, so this one. So I have some information here collected by the agent on the machine where this is running. Here this is not super interesting because the only thing this is collecting is the metric bit machine itself. As I'm running inside Docker, I'm only collecting what is running within this pod exactly. But if you are adding your metric bit agent to whatever service that you have, you will collect that kind of information. And what are the top 10, I don't know, applications which are running, for example, what are the top 10 processes that you have, things along those lines. Anyway, the way I configure MetricBit here, I'm also collecting information coming from the Docker, from Docker itself, and for every single pods that are running. So with that, we built an infrastructure application, which can be super handy as well. If you go to this application, I have nothing. Okay, auto refresh maybe. Okay. Normally, I would have this one. So here you have an overview of the host here. So this is where I'm running my, this is where I'm running my metric bit. But I have also this Docker view. If you are using Kubernetes, you will have the same kind of view with all the pods. And here I can see all the services that are running within my Docker container. And I can see what is the CPU usage, for example, at this moment. So Elasticsearch is serving some few things. PacketBit is collecting some data, for example. I can have a view also of the memory usage here, for example. So if you go above a given limit, then the color of the pod will be here different. Not the pod, the instance. If you look at the traffic that we have, obviously, we have sent some data from back and forth for the MySQL agent with MySQL database, for example. And here, the outbound traffic as well. You can open one of the pods. Let's say I'm going to open this one. And you can go and view the specific metrics, for example, of this one, what have been collected for this one. So you can see the CPU usage for this one, the memory usage, the network traffic, the disk I/O, and what have you. So everything is available all together, so it's super easy even to dig inside your system and see what is exactly happening. Let me show you the configuration of MetricBit. So MetricBit is it's exactly the same thing that we have seen. You start the MetricBit agent. So here I'm just monitoring the system information. And I'm also using here Jolokia. So with Jolokia, I'm able to collect GMX information coming from my front end and from my back end. Okay. So if I look here, I have a Jolokia endpoint. And basically, all the metrics I want to collect are available. And every, I don't know, maybe 10 seconds, I don't know what is the default value, this will gather the information from this URL and index that inside Elasticsearch. Oh, sorry, not the wrong. So here, I'm collecting the information about the collection time and the heap usage, for example. With that, I can go to my visualization again and build my own visualization, because here we don't have default visualization for whatever GMX metrics that we are collecting, obviously. So you can build yourself your own visualization. Let's build one. Let's create a new visualization. I'm going to use here the time series visual builder. Here I need to change the index pattern, so I'm getting information from metric bit here. Okay, those are the events collected by metric bit. What I want to do, I want to not count all the events, but I want to compute what is, for example, the max value of the heap, what's the name, Jolokia max, here. And let's put that in red. Why not? Okay, I can change some options here and say I don't want to fill that. This is a line that I want. So this is the max value. As you can see, this is a raw value. Instead of displaying a number, I'm going to display some bytes here. So this is basically the heap max value that I have here. Let's max heap, why not, heap. Okay, let's do another one. I'm going to collect and to compute the average value of the heap. Why is that? Jolokia used? Yeah, as a green one. And this is heap used. Okay, so with that, I can understand what is the garbage collector cycles and what is my memory currently. There is nothing super interesting here, but we can see here, for example, with 1 hour. So the normal garbage collection cycle, so everything is normal. So what is the point here? If you are missing a feature, then you can just create whatever visualization you want and then put that in a dashboard if you wish to explore that later. Okay, file bit is done, metric bit is done. I'm not going to show you packet bit. There is nothing here interesting to show. What I want to focus on is now is APM. So when I'm starting my Java application, if we look at the Docker Compose again, I'm starting it with, it's here, with a Java agent here. And this Java agent is the Elastic APM agent that we have. And this agent is responsible to collect some information about the execution of your application itself in production. So I'm giving it a name, so I will be able to find that later in the interface. I'm telling the agent where the APM server is running. So this is running here. I have that in the Docker Compose as well. And what are the packages that I want to monitor. Here, this is the backend packages that I want to monitor. And then my jar itself. So this is the only thing that I'm doing. I'm doing the same thing for the frontend here. And if we look at the application itself, so what do I have? In the frontend, for example, so this is a simple REST thing. Like I can call, which one? So the null pointer exception was generated by this one. For example, when I'm calling the search request that we have seen, I'm basically calling the backend then, either without parameter or with a parameter, and then I'm sending back to the interface the result of my search. So anytime I'm running this search for David, for example, so this is what I'm doing from the frontend to the backend to MySQL, back to the backend, back to the frontend, back to the interface. Okay. So because I started my application with the agent, then I'm starting to collect some information about the execution of the process themselves. So if I look here, I have, sorry, just for you to know how to configure that, you just have to follow again the guide here. You go to add APM. So you basically download the version that you want for the server, you edit the configuration, you start it, you check that it's available, yeah, it's available. And then for whatever language that you want, so those are the agents that we have so far, you can install like in the client, in the browser, if you want to monitor the execution in the browser of your customer, then you can use this one. So the Java agent is here, then you start exactly as I mentioned the agent with the Java agent option, and then you check that the agent is running, and you can load Kibana default objects. Then you can go to APM. So here, in APM, I can see that I have information about the backend and the frontend. Those are the things that I'm collecting here. Right. So if I look at the last 15 minutes, why not? And let's refresh every second. Start. So I'm going to see probably that the numbers here are changing. I don't have that many transactions here. So if I go to the frontend, I can see some information about the distribution of the transaction that I have seen so far, the number of requests per minute. I have seen that I have some 404 probably errors here. And those are the endpoint that I'm calling. I'm going to generate more traffic here. So for that, I have a small application, which is test. So every second or every every 100 of milliseconds, this is going to generate some new traffic on my service. So hopefully we are going to see that in a few moments. The traffic increasing, yeah. So we can see a spike now. I have more traffic on my service, which is okay. No more 404 probably. I don't know, maybe some of them. So here, I can see that the impact that I have in my whole application on the front end is the search part. I'm not going to open this one yet. I'm going to look at the backend as well. So same on the backend. I can see some increasing traffic here. And the get all users and the add new person are the most critical parts that I can see here. The search for now seems to be okay, right? So let's have a look at the front end again. Because here I have an impact in the search method. So if I click on this one, I will have more information about this search call itself. And the distribution of the duration of those calls. So for example, I have some small calls, like 100 of milliseconds, which is okay, but I have also some requests which are taking much more time here. I'm going to stop this. So if we look at this one, for example, let's have a look at this one. I can see details about this transaction sample here. So this happened 14 minutes ago. Do I have a more? Yeah, so this one is 2 minutes ago. Okay. So what is interesting here is that when I executed this transaction. This is calling two services, the front-end and the back-end. And what I can see here is that when I'm calling the front-end, then I'm getting the back-end, and I'm calling the back-end with the get all users API. And then inside the back-end, I'm using actually a SQL connection. So here I have all the information about the distribution of my single trust. Okay, so this is distributed tracing, which is available for free. Anytime you are using Elastic, you just collect your data like this, and then you can do, okay, for example, this one take a long time. I want to see what is exactly the what was executed here, what is the select part of this one, for example. Let's have a look at another one. Let's go here. Yeah, I was doing generate. Same, this is taking some time here. If I look at what generate is doing from the front end, it's calling the back end again, it's adding a new person, it's selecting some data, inserting new data, then adding a new person, inserting some data, then adding a new person. So basically, I have here a for loop, and I'm calling the back end as many times as I need from the front end. And if I look at, I don't know, watch, this one for example, maybe the select, no, not this one. Insert. Okay, so this is the insert part here of in my database. So I can have access for that. I'm going to generate some errors to see what is happening, like a slow 500 here, and maybe another one, but a fast one. Maybe we can see some interesting things. So if I look again here at my transactions, I can see that I have some errors now coming. What is the error? Was that, yeah, the bad one, I think. If I look at this one and look at this trust here, yeah, exactly. No, this is not what I wanted to show you. Where is that? No, this is not this one. This was calling the bad. Yeah, I think this is this one I want to see. No, I'm sorry. No, I'm confused now. I wanted to show you the line exactly where the problem is happening, but apparently I cannot see that. Let's try another one. Weird. Okay, sorry. I will try to fix that later, and maybe we can discuss that later on. Okay. Yeah, so basically, this is how you can monitor all the things that you have within the stack. What I want to show you again, where is my thing here? Oops. This end is closed. I was there. Play. Okay. Yeah, this is working again. So I mentioned that you can do other things with the stack. And so I'm going to mention two commercial products that we have, which are coming with the Platinum license, or if you are deploying everything on cloud, this is available by default. So you want to generate alerts, for example, and so you can easily build whatever alert you want on the system. Everything is collected within indices, including the APM things, so those are going to Elasticsearch indices, so you can generate an alert on whatever you want. And we have also the anomaly detection thing, where basically you are trying to detect anomalies within your system. This is typically the case when you cannot define a threshold, because maybe if you put a threshold here at this level, then maybe you will have a lot of false positive there, but you still want to detect that kind of failures. So what the machine learning application is doing, it's computing a model. This is the gray, the light gray part that you are seeing here, which is not accurate at the beginning. But then the model is becoming better and better. So this is what you can see here in blue, in the light blue.
And this model is compared automatically with the new data which is coming through the indices. So the dark blue here is the actual data, which is compared to the model, and because it's outside the computed model, then it's an anomaly that you have to look at. So this is super powerful, and we can also do now forecast, and so extend the model to like try to predict what will be the future, for example, of your service. So with the stack, we have seen this is super flexible. You have multiple elements that you can use, like the agents, bits. I did not show Logstash, but you can use Logstash if you want to enrich your data. Elasticsearch and Kibana. If the default application that we are providing are not enough, you can build your own visualization. This is what we have seen. You can build your own dashboard. And for example, you can have a dashboard which is showing you the metric part, like what is the load on the different machines, the packet bit part, so what are the IOs that you can see on the network level, for example, the log part, how many logs I'm collecting, for example, and the APM part. And then on the same dashboard, you can be able to visualize all those things all together. And you, if you can see that you, with APM, that the response time for the user is getting slower, then you just have to look at the same time frame, and you can see maybe there is an increase of the HTTP request on my services, and then the load on my MySQL database, for example, is too much. So you can just assemble that all together within the same dashboard. Yeah, so this is all what we have seen today. You can build that with the stack. Again, use that for free in production, so go for it. I brought some stickers, by the way. If you want to pick some stickers after the session, you can. And please give a feedback about this session. That session was a bit new. Maybe you noticed that. So please, I would really appreciate some feedback, including the not positive feedback to improve myself about this talk. Maybe I need to improve my English also. Okay, thank you.